Hello, this is Rachel Rofe, and you're listening to A Better Life. So today's podcast is all about what to do if you feel like you've lost your inspiration, and I've kind of titled it A Simple 10-Step Guide to Getting Your Inspiration Back, even when you're burnt out, cranky, and would rather crawl back into bed. We've all definitely had those days where we just don't want to get up, we don't want to do anything, and we're just not motivated at all. So, because I know we all deal with that, I wanted to come up with something that would hopefully help you to at least get out of bed for a little bit and get some of your inspiration in. So, we're going to go through 10 different steps, and you may find that you need to do all of these, maybe some of these, and so just kind of pick whatever has the biggest zing to you. And hopefully this really helps you with just getting your inspiration back. So let's get going. The first step that you can do to get back into your groove is just to go back to your why. So if you're feeling uninspired about something, the best thing that you can do is just figure out why are you doing it. And that's really the most important thing that anything can have is a why. So if there's not something that's bigger than you driving what you're doing, it's going to be really hard to feel motivated to keep going every single day. So why are you even doing what you're doing? Like, why? Maybe it's your job. Maybe it's your, if you're working on a project, if you're an entrepreneur, what's the benefit to you for doing this? It could be just that you're getting paid and that payment is helping you with your family, helping you pay your family, helping you pay your mortgage, your rent, whatever it is. It doesn't mean that this is the thing that you want to do for the rest of your life. But if there's a reason why you're doing it at all, you definitely want to make sure you think about that. Maybe there's also even something other than that. Maybe you have dreams of changing the world and this is going to help you do that. Or maybe you're working extra hard now so that you can take time off later. Maybe you're doing this all because you see that there's a certain change that you want to make, and this is your way of being able to help with that. So those are all the things to think about, like just why did you get into this? And if you don't have a why, then it's definitely never too late to create that. So some of the things to look at when you're creating a why are, first of all, what are your values, and how is this project aligned with them? Do you have a reason for wanting to do that? And you know, it might be that you don't have a why to do this, and so if you can think of one, I would really start to think of if the project is even right for you. Because if you're not feeling motivated and there is no reason to do it that you can think of, then maybe you're not feeling motivated because you're not supposed to be doing it. But some other ways that you can check on trying to figure out a why is, what is working on this or doing whatever you're uninspired about going to mean for you? So think, what will happen if you actually get out of bed and you make this happen? Are you going to maybe feel proud of yourself? You can kind of future pace and see what will happen. Will you feel proud of yourself if you get this done? Will you be able to maybe make a certain amount of money from it? Or will it mean to you that you feel like you're capable of doing big things, getting projects done that you set your mind to? What is the end goal going to be? And when you have that anchor of the why, it's really awesome to just help you start to get some movement created. So that's the first thing. The second thing to do is just understand that every day, you're not going to feel excited every single day. It's just human nature. We're not going to want to jump up, even if we're doing something we love, every single day. And it's really easy, especially if you're creating something yourself, to lose interest initially after you get excited about something. There's always that momentum, that excitement when you first get started. But then things might either be harder than usual, or maybe you're coming against some obstacles you haven't anticipated, or you're not seeing the immediate gratification you wanted to see, or maybe you're just tired. So anticipate that in advance and be okay with it, and know that very few people are excited to get going every single day, no matter what they might tell you in their personal development books or whatever, if you read those. And actually, for women, if you're a woman and you're listening to this, our menstrual cycles have us feeling completely different emotionally at different times of the month. like completely. There's four different phases where we feel totally different. I recommend there's an awesome book called Woman Code by Alisa Vitti. It's A-L-I-S-A and then V-I-T-T-I. And in it, she talks about how different times of the month are going to have us feeling predictably different things. So there's going to be periods where we feel really creative, really energized and focused, more social. And then there's going to be periods where we don't want to do anything. And this is also really big for women entrepreneurs, because a lot of times we might feel like a full-bodied, like, yes, we've made a decision, we want to do it, and then some point later in the month we'll say, oh, you know what, actually doesn't feel right anymore. And it's not that it doesn't feel right, it's just that we're in a different phase in our cycle. So just understand these things are going to happen and account for them. If you've thoughtfully set up a goal and you have your compelling why, the best thing you can really do is stick with your decision. Tell yourself, you know, you trust in your initial decision and you have a why to go with it. So just anticipate it. The next thing to do is just constantly be feeding yourself a diet of motivation. So it's really hard for anyone to stick to anything if they're just having to rely on themselves. Yes, it can happen, but it's a lot easier if you surround yourself with things that are going to naturally lift you up. So if you surround yourself with inspiring things, you'll get to be more inspired. So some things that you can do to feed yourself that diet of motivation, you can listen to podcasts like this. I mean, this is meant to help you see that people can overcome different things and create the kind of lives that they feel proud about. So there's all kinds of podcasts. You can just do searches for whatever you want to hear about. You can read books that are meant to motivate you. There's all kinds of awesome books out there. Just do a search on Kindle, search for feedback. You'll find all kinds of great things. When you're driving or exercising, one of the things I love to do in the mornings, I'll go on the treadmill for 20 minutes and I'll just listen to different audiobooks or podcasts that motivate me. And it's such a great way to get the day started, to hear about people who have reached their dreams. So definitely recommend that. You can go to meetup groups or networking groups that have growth-oriented people so that you surround yourself with the types of people that want to get the same things that you want to get done in their lives. There's a book that I'm reading right now that I think is amazing. It's called The Miracle Morning by Hal Elrod, and I so recommend that you get this, either the audiobook version or there's a Kindle version too. And he talks about having this morning routine every single morning where he sets it out for an hour, but he also talks about how if you only even have 5 minutes, he'll talk to you about how you can get it done in 5 minutes. But just different things you can do to set up your day where you're feeling as positive as possible and really just realizing that you can make the day anything you want. So that's another really great way to go. And I just want you to do whatever you need to do to make sure that your brain is constantly getting infiltrated with just dreams are possible. Things are possible. Even when there's obstacles, you can make this happen. So definitely add that. And again, even if you don't have extra time, you can just do this while you're exercising, while you're driving, listening to the audiobooks. So I would definitely recommend, yes, like carve out time to do this if you can. But if you can't, sneak it into things that you're doing anyway. You can listen to audiobooks as you're doing the laundry, as you're if you live in a city and you walk around, as you're driving, whatever. So definitely put that stuff into your life. The next thing is take small, consistent actions every day. So as we talked about, you're not going to feel 100% raring to go every day, but tell yourself that you're committed to consistency anyway, even when you're not in the mood. So even if you're creatively flatlining, you can do something to give respect to your project. It might be even just sending out a little email or mapping something out, coming up with some ideas. Even if you just start creating something, even if it's a horrific first draft, it's still better than nothing, and it still shows you that you're committed to what you're doing. So I would just keep writing that, just do a little bit every day to give some momentum to the project. It's also going to just really help you set your neural patterns in your brain to show you that you're going to do this project even when it's not comfortable. And the more you do things when you're not comfortable with it, the more your neural patterns, your brain's going to start to recognize that you don't stop just because you don't feel like doing something. So sometimes it's just having 5 minutes of courage to see past the not wanting to do it and just doing it anyway. And eventually it will get easier with time. Also, of course, taking the consistent actions are going to help you get closer to the results that you wanted, which of course are going to inspire you more and get you more motivated anyway, because you're going to start to get that gratification. So once those results start to show up, of course, you'll start to go full circle. You'll get back to that same spark of passion that you had in the beginning. And only this time, of course, you're going to be pride. You're going to have pride in yourself, a knowingness that you can follow through on things, and a really good story to tell people. Another thing that you can do is have mental conversations with people that you who have done things that you Another thing you can do is have conversations with people who have done things that you feel proud of. So this is a little bit out there, but it's kind of, just listen to me on it because I think it's actually really helpful. So basically do an inventory and find out, ask yourself, who inspires you? Who are your heroes? And learn more about them. So if they have autobiographies, read them. If they have Facebook pages, go on their Facebook pages. Learn more about their mindset and how they think. And maybe you can even talk to them. Maybe you can send them a message on Facebook or Twitter. You can also even just have mental conversations with them. Like remember those What Would Jesus Do bracelets that were really big for a while? You can kind of do the same thing with the people that inspire you. So ask them in your head, like, what would you do if you hit this snag? Or what would you do if you were feeling not motivated? And, or how would you respond if someone said this to you? Whatever the question is, whatever you're feeling not motivated about, just ask them. Or if that doesn't feel comfortable, just say, what would whoever do? And you'll start to get some answers and some clarity for yourself, because a lot of times it can be really hard to pull ourselves out of a funk. But when you have something outside of yourself, it really helps you gain that perspective. The next thing to do is just look into your energy levels. So it may be that you're just not feeling motivated, but if you find that this is happening over and over, it might be that you just need to set yourself up for success energy-wise, and you have to kind of look at what you can do to support your body more. So for example, I would check and see, are you getting enough water? I know for me that when I have a lot of water, when I drink a lot of water throughout the day, then I'm definitely way more energized than when I don't. When I feel dehydrated, I feel drained, and there's an awesome app. It's called Waterlogged, and it'll just go through and you can track however much water you drink throughout the day. So it's really simple, and it's a really great way to make sure that you're getting in your water. So they say to drink half of your body weight in ounces. So definitely try to do that. One of the things that you can do is just when you wake up in the morning, have 8 or 16 ounces of water. I like to have 16 or even more. First thing, I have my water sitting right next to my bed at night. And so I wake up, boom, have it. It's a really great way to start getting in the water. You also might want to look and make sure that you're getting enough greens in your diet. So I know that greens will give you a lot of long-lasting natural energy. And the great thing about having lots of green vegetables or that, it doesn't give you that in your head kind of shaky feeling like maybe you get with sugary things or even fruit sometimes. But it gives you a consistent, sustained energy. So look at where can you get more greens in your diet? And maybe that's just having those greens powders, like athletic greens or something, and mixing that in your morning smoothie. Or maybe it's even making a smoothie, but that would be something that could really help. One thing that really helps me with managing my energy levels, and I recommend it to everybody, is keeping a food log. So the nutritionist that I'm working with, her name is Ginny Johnson. She's amazing. And she's had me keep a food log where I track how I feel before and after anything that I eat, what my hunger level is on a 1 to 10 of anything that I eat before and after, and then what I'm eating in the situation in which I'm eating it. And so it's been really helpful for me to track and see what foods make me tired that I've never realized make me tired, what foods make me really energized and happy. And so I definitely recommend keeping that food log, because you're going to gain a lot of valuable insight. You'll be able to start optimizing for feeling at your peak. You also might want to consider how much you're exercising. Sometimes even just getting up in the morning and doing 20 minutes of exercise, even if it's just a power walk, will be really great in helping you get your energy back. So these are all kind of things that are maybe small, but they add up to really help you become your best self. Another thing you can do is just work less. So if right now you're feeling exhausted and you're just burnt out, I want to remind you not to be busy just because you can be busy. So One of the things that a lot of people do is they work all the time and they use it as a badge of honor. So they love to talk about how busy they are and they love to tell everybody how busy they are. But as Tim Ferriss says, who's an author, he's an awesome, awesome author, he talks about how being busy is really a form of mental laziness. It's lazy thinking and it's indiscriminate action. So it's basically just doing a bunch of things that are in front of you instead of really taking the time to think about, well, what are my highest leverage action steps? So if you're finding that you're at the computer constantly or you're doing the same things constantly, you're feeling like a hamster on a wheel and you're not making progress, I would say it's time to reevaluate what you're doing and just start to do the things that have the highest impact for your project or for your job or for whatever it is. I would also say work smarter, not harder. So take some time to think about what you really need to move ahead on a project. I know a lot of times people come up with all these different ideas to get things done, but scale it back again to the most important action steps. And then once you identify those, just cut all the busy tasks and just focus on those highest impact things. After you figure out what those highest impact activities are, cut your work hours. You're going to be amazed to see that when you focus on just what's important, you'll create more results in 3 hours than you could in 12, easily. You just go through and schedule whatever hours you want to work. And if you just have focused action on those things, you'll find that if you cut out Facebook and you cut out social media, you'll be able to just make really amazing things happen. And then, of course, when you're working less hours, it'll reduce your burnout. It's going to give you time to go live life, which will help you stimulate your creativity, bring back new inspiration and excitement into your life. And then, of course, it's going to end up helping you with whatever you're working on anyway. You also might want to consider outsourcing. So I love myfancyhands.com. You might want to go on Fiverr. There's all different types of places where you can outsource for very inexpensively. Another thing I recommend doing with the work is just to work in blocks of time. So make sure that the time you're utilizing is utilized as well as possible. So make sure the time that you're spending on your work is utilized as well as possible. So I've already said if you work, let's say, 3 hours instead of 12 hours, you might be shocked at how much more you can get done. And within those 3 hours, there's ways that you can set it up where you maximize even that time. One of the things that's awesome is to set up blocks of time to work. So, for example, maybe you work 50 minutes, 5-0, and then you take a 10-minute break. So you just have 50 minutes of a very concentrated task, and then you get your break. And boom, boom, boom. So for example, it might be something like you wake up, you start working from 8 to 11, and from 8 to 8:50, you write a blog post or a rough draft of one. From 8:50 to 9, you take a break. From 9 to 9:50, maybe you reach out to 20 potential places that you want to guest blog post in. 9:50 to 10, you take your break. 10 to 10:50, you answer 20 crucial emails or 20 emails. And then 10:50 to 11, you take a break. And so if those are your three highest impact activities for the day, then that's great. When you have these little blocks of time and you don't force yourself to keep working and you have some time to regenerate within the breaks, then it's awesome. And if you go to rachelrofe.com/abcgift, I have a software that I'm giving for free. It's normally $97 that you can use to time yourself for each specific thing. And once you have that timeline, you're not going to be crawling off onto Facebook. So it's just going to help you focus on getting your goal done. It's going to help you make more progress every day, which once you make more progress, you're going to feel happier, more prouder of yourself every night when you go to bed. And then, of course, it's going to help with your inspiration. So it'll all come full circle. Another thing to do is just work in surroundings that feel good to you. You know how when you clean like a closet or something that had been messy for way too long, a desktop maybe, and you clean it up and then it just feels so good to have it clean? That feeling extends to everything. So check out your desk. If your desk is messy, even if it's your computer desktop or your desk where you actually work, take some time to clean it. So organize your papers, throw out what you don't need, and just give yourself that magical feeling that comes with decluttering. And then once you do that and it's a nice clean area, then put some things in there that inspire you and make you feel really good. So depending on what inspires you the most, maybe you'll post pictures of your family or people who inspire you or quotes that motivate you. You could even do just post-it notes of the goals that you have. You can also add some beauty to your desk. So maybe have a candle that smells really great to you or fresh flowers, or maybe it's even a new notebook to write in or a pen that you really like. And if your computer desktop is full of icons and files and stuff that you don't use anymore, then declutter that. When I had my computer stolen about a year and a half ago, it was one of the best things that could have ever happened because I got rid of all this stuff that was just really taking up psychic energy. So I think keeping things as lean as possible is always a really great idea. It keeps you kind of free to take in new things and just have more inspiration and a flow in your life. And then the last thing that I would recommend is just to set up some accountability. So it can be really hard to go about things by yourself. And if you have people around you who know what your goals are, then it really motivates you to get more things done. So I recommend, I have a podcast coming out about tools that I love. There's one tool called stickk.com. It's stick with two K's. And that's a really great goal setting tool. There's apps, there's the Lift app. Or you can just find a friend or find someone in a Facebook group, whatever. But tell people what you want to get accountable, be held accountable for, and then do it. So especially on the days where it would be much easier to crawl into bed, if you know that you're going to have to tell somebody that you're going to get something done, or that you either did or you didn't, it's going to motivate you a little bit more because you don't want to look bad, or maybe for you, you just want to, you're either motivated that you don't want to look bad, or you want to just be excited to tell your friend that you've gotten things done. So I would set goals either every month, well, I set goals every year and then every month, but for you with your accountability partner, either meet with them once a week or once a day or once a month or all three, and just have someone where you, or multiple people, where you just share what you've gotten done and they can share back with you what they've gotten done. If you guys are working on similar goals, you can all brainstorm solutions to things. But it's all really, really helpful. And you can even, if you want, just report back on Facebook. Even if you don't have anybody that you necessarily can mastermind with, you can say on Facebook, I'm committing to getting this done by Friday. If I don't, here's what's going to happen. And then just post at that time and let people know that you've got it done. So there's all kinds of ways that you can hold yourself accountable. So I think that if the biggest thing, of course, is you're having a why. So as long as you have a why for what you're doing, then these other steps should really help you make sure that you start to get some of your inspiration back and you're able to get out of bed. And I really hope that this helps you. This helps you get more motivated and inspired. And I'm going to look forward to talking with you in our next podcast. So for now, have a great day. Talk to you soon.